I have the utmost respect for Buddhism, but I don't really know it that well. Why? Because there's so much to know. I mean, I seem to know a lot, but I actually don't know hardly anything. Right? That's the nature. It's so amorphously huge. I mean, what do you say? So, I really don't say much about it. But I do love it. I do love it. I do respect it. And it's fantastic teachings. So, I was brushing up on my Buddhism today a little bit. It's a little clearer, but I have, you know, there's so many different viewpoints and so many different variations and so much, you know, it's just wow. I did find that Gautama, Siddhartha, the Buddha, historical Buddha that we know, was actually the 28th Buddha. There had been 27 previous in different eras and cycles. And there'll be many more. And even before those, apparently, in the celestial realms, there's so many, 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 innumerable, you know, ones who had reached, you know, perfect enlightenment, nirvana, which I call the vision of oneness. I call nirvana the vision of oneness. So there's a great deal of similarity to what I'm sharing in Buddhism, actually, a great deal. But what I get is coming more from Jesus Christ in A Course in Miracles and from my own contemplation. But it's all, truth is all one anyway. So it makes sense that that when we talk about this, it says, oh, that's very similar to this, very similar to this, very similar to this, yeah. Oneness is oneness, that's it. But I have come up with some sharing which seems to be somewhat, it comes from my own organic, you know, the process of what I'm contemplating from the Holy Spirit. And it tends to have its own uniqueness to it. The continuity problem, for instance, is something I haven't heard really anyone really talk much about. Jesus mentions it, something like that, in A Course in Miracles. And for me, it's all important continuity problem. Buddha mentions the four noble truths of suffering. What he called dukkha or something, anxiety, dissatisfactions, misery. What I saw last night is actually, it all comes from waiting. I realize the essence of our trouble, other than the continuity problem, what gives rise to the continuity problem is our waiting. Waiting is inherently dissatisfaction. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for reality to be changed, to be split. We're waiting for pure spaciousness to be split, for a seam to split, for we get our kingdom that splits off separately from so-called God's kingdom. So we're waiting for that to happen. And as we wait for that to happen, we honor our desire, believing it will be fulfilled eventually, that the waiting magically, that it's going to happen, we just need to wait for it. And if it hasn't happened yet, it means we haven't waited long enough. And so we're honoring our waiting by all this existence, this dance of duality, of form, of more and less, light and dark, good and evil, this dance of existence and impermanence. It is a way to honor our presumed eventual success, and how will we function in a split kingdom, split of pure spaciousness. And it also makes us believe that the suffering we're experiencing is coming from external to our waiting. Comes from this dance of suffering. So we don't realize the suffering is actually, our waiting is the suffering. Our waiting is the suffering. So Buddha, his way of teaching was the middle path in age, a balance between asceticism and sensuality. At this time, the sensuality has become so bad, and the world is so dark. I look at it slightly differently than that. Now, apparently each Buddha teaches a different way for a different era, depending on what the makeup of that era is. And Gautama Buddha, the Buddha of this era, taught the middle path. Balance, don't go either way too much. Well, it's so out of balance right now that, I see it a little differently now, because it's the end of an era, beginning of a new era, and all of that. So I'm looking at it in a slightly different context. Waiting is the problem. We're waiting for reality to be split. And we, our negotiator, I call the goddess, our negotiator, the one we believe can strike a deal with God, is our own imagination, is our own desire, is the form of our desire, negotiating with God to get God to agree to a split. Or to charm God into saying, well, the split is already there and accept it. Or to remove the blindness from God. We think that the split is there, but God can't see it, and therefore it's blinding us, to get rid of the residual blindness. Actually, the split isn't there, and our belief that it is there, thinking that we're seeing it in duality, is hallucination of blindness. That's the hallucination of blindness. There is no split in oneness. And there never will be. There never will be. Therefore, we have a continuity problem. Those who believe that we're just celebrating and rehearsing for functioning in our new split off kingdom, they don't think they have a continuity problem, because they think, well, we don't have to go back to oneness because it's split, or going to be split. So they remain, uninterested in the continuity issue, the continuity problem. Because how do we go from all this rehearsing and belief and hallucinating blindness in a split of oneness to realizing there is no split, never has been, never will be. The oneness is still completely oneness without, and God has not had the slightest reaction or interest in this effort to split it. There's been no war between God and us, spirit, truth and lies. There is no war whatsoever. There's no threat to reality by our imaginings, our desire to split reality. Because any split that happens, that too is in the oneness, within the everywhereness, the pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness is this. Longchenpa points it out beautifully. He's a master of this, talking about pure spaciousness. He was a Tibetan Buddhist, which is what? Mahayana, type of Mahayana, Vajrayana, whatever. You got all these different bodhisattva categories, all different lineages, and whoa, just your head can spin. And a lot of people try to master all these details and stuff, but that's like basically trying to count all the trees in a forest instead of just saying, oh, there's a forest here, okay, let's get out of the forest. I mean, one of the central teachings of Buddhism is you're supposed to view your situation as if you're living in a house and the house is on fire. And that's what, so you don't sit around counting the number of tiles in the floor when your house is on fire, right? You get to work earnestly, dealing with that fire. So I don't get into all this. Buddhism can give rise to just this enormous amount of spiritual intellectualism. Yeah, I don't go for that at all. They don't really, they just forget it. House is on fire. Waiting, the problem is waiting. What do? Drop the waiting. Bliss. Now, what we expect from the waiting is that a transformative bliss. What we're looking for is called a transformative bliss. And transformation means transformation of something. So this drives the wheel of what's called samsara in Buddhism, which is the realm of duality, of all this relative differences, in which it seems possible that there's better and worse. As soon as you say better, you got worse. You see, the whole idea of being greater than God, is better, something better than God, is automatically there's something worse than what you think you can have. And then there's that dichotomy, that duality arises. And then you feel the better is threatened by the worse, automatically. And then this gives rise to this vast outpouring of what the Buddhism calls samsara, of differences, perceived differences. And the attempt to master this, to somehow get this transformative bliss, meaning our waiting is transformed into bliss, the feeling of our waiting, which is non-bliss, which is unhappiness, unfulfillment. Because what we want, desire, is the splitting of reality. We haven't got it yet, really. So we feel that at some point that this unhappiness will be transformed into bliss, and that will then mean that oneness has been split. So we do all these efforts to reach transformative bliss, lots of types of different lifetimes. We're engaging in all these efforts to transform this feeling of dissatisfaction into pure, perfect, effortless satisfaction, bliss, called transformative bliss. That's what we're waiting for. That would be the culmination. We feel, well, we haven't got it yet because we haven't succeeded yet, but we will succeed. And the attempt to success is all of this struggle in duality with trying to get what is good and discard what is bad. And it involves all these different cycles and lifetimes and efforts and various realms of this vast dream, really. But when we simply set waiting down, what we have is just bliss. It's not transformative bliss, it's just bliss. It's not transforming anything, it's just pure, it's just bliss. That's why I use the double down phrase, bliss, peace, joy. Not transformative, it's just bliss. Not transformative bliss, not transformative joy, not transformative peace, it's not transforming anything. And that's why we jump back and say, oh, wait a minute, I see the bliss, but what is it transforming? And that's still spiritual ambition. This morning I was aware of spiritual ambition to an unparalleled extent, of just seeing all the so many levels and variations of spiritual ambition. It's amazing. So spiritual ambition drives all of this. It drives the want, the waiting. It drives the vast dream of duality. It dreams that waiting for this transformative bliss. It's spiritual ambition. Spiritual ambition. And spiritual ambition, like I saw, it shows up in so many, 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 many ways. Wow. Amazing. Tremendous meditation. Just as I was going about my work, I was able to see all this. The desire to be greater. You see, we're locked into the desire to be greater, which presupposes lesser, which immediately brings rise this feeling of insecurity, like fear, like, wait a minute, I also could get the lesser. How do I avoid the lesser? So there's avoidance. How do I avoid the lesser? And I think in Buddhism they talk about nirvana. It's a state of mind where there's no attraction and there's no revulsion. In other words, you're not going to get something greater that's better, and you're not trying to avoid something that's lesser. You know, it basically is the vision of oneness. Nirvana is the vision of oneness. Now, a Buddha is said to be someone who's perfectly established in the vision of oneness. There's very different phrase, terminology, and it's very confusing. But the goal is very simple. We don't need all this complexity, spiritual, religious complexity. Vision of oneness is the goal, period. And it doesn't matter. Nothing else matters. Nothing else matters. We simply sit down, waiting, and that's it. And there's bliss, because we now see the oneness and realize there is no greater or lesser. And so there is no more fear of losing your happiness, your state. The idea of transformative bliss is you've attained something greater. Well, what happened to the lesser? How can you say it's greater unless there's a lesser? So you end up pursuing these higher realms in the dream. and thinking that you're, you know, you're a goddess or a god, and you reached high places within the dream. That's still entirely, you know, it's still entirely spiritual ambition. There's nothing but spiritual ambition. Spiritual ambition, the play is so intense. I see people who are not getting after the continuity problem. No Buddha repentance. And I realize that they're saying, hey, you know, I'm greater than you because I can get even in even deeper problems than you and still free myself, get free. You see, so I'm greater. So there's this tremendous pursuit of greaterness. But the truth is, in oneness, there is no dichotomy of greater and lesser whatsoever. There's no such thing as I have a greater enlightenment than you somehow. It's impossible. What do you mean? There's only oneness. The real Buddha is the one that sees Buddha nature everywhere, Buddha mind everywhere. There's just oneness everywhere. That's all there is. That's all there's ever been. That's all there ever will be. That there's no gradations, really. There's no gradations at all. So the very notion of pursuing, you know, greaterness, I realize that everybody here is jostling for how do I get greater? How do I get better? How can I, maybe if I just wait longer. Now, another way of spiritual ambition is to say, well, I'm just honoring my desire to separate from God. I'm just honoring it more than you are. That's why I'm not repenting. I'm playing out this vast dream of duality, of greater and lesser. I'm playing that out more. That's why I'm not repenting, because I'm honoring my desire to my creativity in creating all this dream scenario that seems to show, you know, hope and rehearsing for presumed success. In other words, it's a presumption of success, which is honoring our creativity. They say, well, I'm not repenting because I'm honoring more than you are. So I'll get a higher place in heaven than you because I've honored spirit and thus God more than you have. That's why I'm delaying more than you. So it becomes this contest, who can delay the longest, as to who gets the highest place. But this is all entirely delusional spiritual ambition based on the idea of these higher dream realms these psychic projections, really. They're not really us. This whole dream realm is just psychic projections, the way when we dream when we go to sleep. It's not us at all. All these figures, gods and goddesses, these are psychic projections, these are dream figures. And so they feel that they're gaining higher places. There's no higher or lower in oneness. To say that you're higher presupposes that you can also be lower, which means you have to try to control what is lower. You know, I don't want to go down there. Find a way, some magic, some psychic powers, all this stuff. I want to be worshipped to make sure that I don't go down lower. And so the gods and goddesses are very much into being worshipped, you know, and being served and all this kind of stuff. These are dream figures, psychic projections. There is no higher or lower in reality. Really, we honor our creativity by repenting. Everyone has to repent. We honor because we're honoring our freedom. And our freedom is that we're always free, forever free. We can't imprison ourselves. So the desire to imprison ourselves, letting go of that, is also honoring what we are, our creativity too. But however long we take, however much we honor it, doesn't make any difference at all. Doesn't make any difference. There's only one. So it's really spiritual ambition to delay. And so what is delay? It's spiritual ambition, plain and simple. Plain and simple, it's spiritual ambition. Which is what? It's just a whim. Adventurous whim, saying, hey, this might be a cool adventure. That's all we did. We said, hey, this might be a really interesting adventure. This looks like a real whopper, you know, amazing one. Let's see what happens. So, okay. And maybe people say, I'm more adventurous than you are, etc. Yeah, but where are you adventuring in dualistic delusion? This whole spiritual competitiveness, really. I noticed there's this vast spiritual competitiveness. It's all spiritual competitiveness. The desire to be greater than God gives rise to this spiritual competitiveness, spiritual ambition. And people don't take to heart what's being said because they say, well, how can I, you know, be better than you, spiritually better than you? There is no such thing as spiritually better. All is all. All is all. All is totally one with pure spaciousness, with everywhereness. There isn't any way to leave it. There isn't. So, since it's impossible to leave it, to leave the oneness, how can anyone be better or worse off? It's not possible. There's no such thing as better or worse off. Reality is not a competitive environment at all. And since we've been so spiritually competitive for so long, again, we wonder, I don't know how to function. We're not a function. You know, so that's a continuity problem, isn't it? It's a continuity problem. So that's why I say humility, the mood of repentance, is very important. Just listening in non-competitive mindset. You're not in competition with anything. You're just saying, hey, you know, this waiting will always be suffering. Waiting is suffering. Waiting is suffering. It will always be suffering because the transformative bliss never comes. The transformative bliss, we believe, will come from the split actually happening. It won't ever actually happen. So we simply wait in vain. We wait in vain. We wait in vain. That's it. And we work on the notion of this transformative bliss, rehearsing for it through all these forms, through pleasure and pain, pleasure and pain. We have the pain, and we try to transform it into pleasure. And then it gets back transformed back into pain, so we can work again and transform into pleasure. So you have all these cycles of pleasure and pain working on this notion of transformative bliss, which is supposed to transform our waiting into success. We did it. We said we did it. We split reality. We split reality. We split oneness. So, of course, when you have this spiritual ambition of splitting oneness and you're waiting, which is this state of total unfulfillment, you believe that it'll succeed and there'll be this transformative bliss. So you say, well, maybe I'm not succeeding because I have a continuity problem with that, you see. We say, I'm not sure how to function in a split kingdom, so I need to rehearse this. I don't know what transformative bliss will be like. I've never experienced it. So how is that going to work? And so we rehearse in a dream. It's like a dream rehearsal. The dream is like a rehearsal, the dream rehearsal for transformative bliss, where we have this impermanence, which signifies the waiting, the unhappiness of waiting, of unfulfillment, of you know, collapsing, failure to succeed. And then we have the efforts to keep these forms alive, right? Keep them alive, drive away pain, you know, the cold, the harshness, the starving, the sickness, all these things which symbolize the unfulfillment of waiting, the lack of any success of waiting. We symbolize it through death, which is, you know, failure, and then rehearse how do we prevent death, how do we nurture quote-unquote life, which is the symbol of transformative bliss. And so we rehearse this transformative bliss as a way to kind of smooth the way, we think, for eventual real transformative bliss, which is change the waiting, the feeling of waiting. The feeling of waiting is no longer there. We have now succeeded. No more need for waiting. You see that? And that will transform how we feel, how waiting feels. It's transformed. So transformation of feeling, we start off with, you know, the zero feeling, the terrible death, as it were. And then we try to avoid that. That's the game of the dream. And it, of course, it's got endless variations. Really, the variations are endless. You see people battling, like rich people battling over a painting or something, and it's like life and death for them. You see, they got everything, but they're pulling each other's hair out over some, you know, antiquity, some ancient antiquity. They must have it. It signifies more. It signifies their rehearsal for transformative bliss, the whole purpose of the dream. Rehearse transformative bliss. Now, to awaken from the dream, give up the notion of transformative bliss and just accept bliss. The bliss that is always there when you're not trying to split the bliss. Just stop trying to split bliss, split oneness, and you'll experience a oneness. And you don't need any success in the dream. The whole dream, the whole success is a rehearsal for transformative bliss. To transform something that is not blissful into bliss. There's no such situation of something that is not blissful. There's only the one bliss. It's all bliss. It's all happiness. There's no such thing as transformative bliss. It's something we've imagined. So the whole dream, this whole rehearsal, is just nothing. It doesn't do anything. It's a complete waste, a meaningless waste, actually. So my desire has always been to streamline spiritual teaching, streamline it, make it very simple, very clear, very simple. That's it. Wrap the whole thing up in a nutshell. I say, there's nothing more to it. And there really isn't. Of course, when people want to severely rehearse their transformative bliss, you get asceticism and sensuality, you know, of course. And Buddha said, well, it's the middle way between these two. And of course, a lot of wiggle room is there. Now, we have a situation here where those who want to pursue transformative bliss through rehearsing in this dream rehearsal of bodies, of forms, subject to decay, of course, and all sorts of harm, therefore giving them opportunity to prevent that harm, which is a rehearsal for transformative bliss, they're going to split off and they're going to, you know, do their thing intensely. And others are no longer interested in that, really. And they're not interested in asceticism either. Which asceticism is an attempt to say, hey, I don't mind the pain. I'm going to shortcut this and say, well, bring on the pain. It doesn't affect me in any way. Pain of form. It's like, oh, okay, well, dissolution, it doesn't bother me. Because I don't need to pursue pleasure. All these people desperately trying to pursue pleasure, I'll cheat the whole system. And I'll just say, well, if I get pain or pleasure, pain's okay. It's not a problem. I can hold my hand up like this for 10 years, you know. that's transformative, you know. But not interested in that in the slightest bit. So not even interested in either asceticism or sensuality. Then you just can go directly to the simple teaching. Don't need any other stuff. You just can just see the big picture easily. So, okay, yeah. Just waiting for transformative bliss, rehearsing for that, thinking the rehearsal will somehow remove the blockage to it. The dream rehearsal has infinite variations in it, of course. We don't need any of it, it's all futile. There's no such thing as transformative bliss. Just set the desire to be greater than God down. There is no split, nothing needs to be transformed. Just drop the waiting. That's it. Just set the waiting down. That simple. See, asceticism is like, I can transform the pain. It's still transformative, isn't it? You're trying to figure some way to transform something. There's nothing needs to be transformed. There's no, in oneness, what is there to be transformed in oneness, in everywhereness? Nothing. Nothing at all. There's no need for any transformation whatsoever. So all pursuit of transformation is spiritual ambition, plain and simple. And why do we keep doing it? Continuity problem. because we're thinking like, wow, how am I going to function without transformation? How am I going to function in oneness? How am I going to function in just bliss? How am I going to function with no spiritual competition? You're like, what? It's like the whole landscape is gone, you know, the whole landscape. No spiritual ambition. How can I? Maybe I'll just be completely listless and bored, you know, because this dream seems so interesting. It's not really interesting. It's actually very stressful and frightening and not at all enjoyable, that's for sure. It's just that the ambition drives us so severely that we don't really have time to complain. We just, you know, on to the next thing, on to the next thing. It's just like this. Business mindset of just more and more and more, and you know, you just, as long as you think that you're moving forward and getting more, you think I'm winning. And there again, innumerable variations on it. The spiritual ambition crops up in so many subtle ways. Get what they got, but I'm going to get it that it's going to come to be easy. See, that's more transformative. I'm going to find a sneaky, manipulative way to get what someone else had to fight for, claw for. Like the diamond magnates, South African diamond mines, and these big industrial people, you know, just blood, sweat, and tears to get the diamonds. They employ people to go and dig down, and it's incredible, you know, blood, sweat, and tears to get the diamonds. And then the security to fight over these, that have to protect them and shape them, cut them, all the massive amount of work that goes into the diamond. And then the beautiful lady will say, you know, I'm I don't seem attractive enough to you. And the man says, no, you're very, very attractive, you know. And he says, I want you so much, you're so attractive, this is what I want. Well, he says, you know, I see something lacking in your desire, because I just don't feel I'm quite attractive enough. The man says, no, I can tell, I'm just, you know, something holding me back, because I feel I'm not attractive enough. The man goes, what are you talking about? He says, well, and then she goes, well, okay, let's drop it. Then they go out, she takes them out shopping. Let's go out for a walk. We go past a jewelry store. She says, oh my God, let's go in. Look at this, it's so beautiful. And then she finds a diamond. You know, she already knows the diamond she wants. She says, let's put this one on. Jewelry, let's put this jewelry on. Oh my gosh, I feel so different. Do you see it? And I can tell in your eyes that I'm more attractive now. And there's a connection now, you see. Just, that's how it is. And she says, yeah, this does it. I can see the desire in your eyes is complete now. It's complete. This jewelry's complete. And the guy's, yeah. And she just waits for the guy to say, well, I gotta buy it for you then. So, you know, it's that easy. And the guy says, well, how much is it? Oh my God, $50,000. Okay, this will make my life happy and complete. You know, I can see there's this connection. So she gets the diamond jewelry and plays that for a while, and then later on says, you know, it seems like something's lacking now. It's kind of worn off. It is that your desire's not quite there. And then the guy says, well, what, we need some more jewelry? What? Oh yeah, as a matter of fact, you know, these emeralds or rubies, whatever. It's just like that. So, this is extreme spiritual ambition to get more, to get better, to get all this jewelry. To say this is rehearsing for transformative bliss, right? Without having to do all the dirty work. Meanwhile, there's this whole massive, dirty, messy, blue-collar, slave labor thing going on to dig out these gems out of the earth. People getting killed right and left, dying of sickness, of severe labor fatigue, having their bodies broken, and these business interests fighting each other with, you know, security firms and intrigue, and it's just, you know, vicious jungle type of fighting thing. All this stuff's going on. There's a huge apparatus to get those jewels into that jewelry store, and the lady, all she has to say, to the rich man is, you know, gosh, you know, I just don't, I'm not quite feeling, you know, the attraction, the desire. It's almost there, almost there. But I'm just not sure what is it that's going to light the fire. I mean, the fire's smoldering, but it's just not, the flame is not yet there. Oh, look at this diamond necklace. Oh, that's it. That's done it. Just get up just like that. So that's a very clever, you know, very clever, but supremely spiritually ambitious, right? The idea is, you know, and I need so much transformation and bliss. I think I figured it out. I just need to, you know, collect this massive jewelry collection, you know, and that will do it for me because I'll have more than anybody else. And so in order to do that, I have to get it quick and fast. So I need to be this, you know, this come on trick and gold digger, you know, dig the gold out of all these men who've fought, you know, blood, sweat, and tears for so long. That, so that's, you know, and they say, oh, no, there's no ambition there. The guy wanted to buy it for me. I just said, well, okay, he likes it. He wanted to get it for me. I wasn't, you know, there's no ambition. No, there's extreme ambition there. Extreme looking for transformative bliss in the extremely intense way. So the guy, I always say the goddess is the one that's the most extremely intense. That's where the spiritual ambition is most extremely intense, because she's the one who's attained all the jewelry, all the ornamentation, all the finery. And in order to do that, you have to be very, very clever, right, in getting people who have fought so hard to get that, worked so hard, lifetime to get that, to part with it, you know, quickly and easily. That's, you know, supreme ambition to gain transformative bliss, to make the waiting be transformed into success and splitting reality into two. So again, spiritual ambition, you need to see the you know, see that you start seeing the whole picture, and you start recognizing it. It's like, wow, the whole scene, the whole dream is spiritual ambition. Now, what about the man? He has this beautiful lady with the diamond necklaces, and he says, hey, look what I have. You see, look, this is transformative bliss, you see. So he's ambitious too, right? That's the trophy wife sort of thing. Look at my success. Look at my, and of course the woman knows that's what he's looking for. So she gets her jewelry and everything. So it's all this dance of spiritual ambition, transformative bliss, trying to rehearse for it. We never reach bliss in the dream. We're rehearsing for it. And we never reach transformative bliss at all, because there is no such thing. So the man is searching for transformative bliss. The clever woman says, oh, I can see you're searching for transformative bliss. Well, here I am, but I'm not quite yours yet. First, you got to, you know, set me up so that you can recognize. You just don't recognize it yet entirely. So if you set me up right, turn me into a goddess, then you'll realize you have transformative bliss. The guy says, wow, it's right within my grasp. I just need to get more and more. And so there's this treadmill. And of course, men are blamed for being egotists, or, you know, are trying to be spiritually ambitious, but, you know, it's the yin and the yang. Oh, this whole dream is the yin and the yang. It's all a search. All of it, a search for transformative bliss. The whole dream. The entire dream. All of it. And the competition in it. So I'm not really into that. You can trust me, I'm not really that much into that. No, this is not, you're not being taken, you know. I'm not really spiritually ambitious, are you kidding? But it's all this ego game, right? The whole dream is an ego game of spiritual ambition, of rehearsing for transformative bliss. It's all an ego game. All of samsara is just an ego game. It's an ego trip. Of more and less, winning and losing, and higher, lower, rehearsing for success. And we feel that successful rehearsal for transformative bliss will result in it. That will, we proclaim it. Remember, we believe we're going to have a separate kingdom from God. We're going to be the prime creator of this kingdom. So we simply believe in decreeing. Whatever we want to decree, we decree. We say, the rehearsing for transformative bliss, as soon as we do it right, it will work, and it'll be successful. We have decreed it will be successful, so it will be. So you have to be very cognizant of all these decrees of this samsara, of this dream of transformative bliss. And we put words in the mouth of this God, our decrees, and say, it's coming from this God, these decrees. See, this is what God wants for us. And so we follow, these worship this God, follows God, but it's just the God of our own spiritual ambition. It's the God of our own spiritual ambition that most of us are worshiping. God of our own desire, God of our own spiritual ambition. We put words in the mouth of this God so that we hear the decrees coming from this God and say, oh, I must follow these decrees. It's a way of hiding from ourselves the fact that we're just making these decrees up. Just making them up. We'll say, sure, waiting will be transformed at some point. We just have to rehearse properly. Once we rehearse properly, the transformative bliss will arrive. Arrive, and that will be the experience that is now the, we're experiencing the split kingdom, the separate kingdom. So the vision of oneness is just a matter of seeing this and say, oh, okay, it doesn't work. So we just stop waiting, just set the waiting down. And waiting is the form of our desire. Oh, I can't do it now. Well, that's because I'm waiting. Waiting is part of the deal. So since it can't happen, what can we say except, well, we're waiting for it? The inevitability is inevitable, but we're just waiting for it. Which of course is time, isn't it? Waiting implies time. We're waiting for something to happen. There's no time in reality. Everything is. No such thing as waiting for something to happen. Reality is instantaneous, spontaneous, instantaneous. There can never be a not happening. Other than it can't be split. the split cannot happen. So there's never such a thing as not happening. The allness is always the allness. So we're just looking at this waiting, just looking at the situation. Get I call it the big picture, the big picture, the big picture, which really doesn't need to look at anything else. If we're able to look at the big picture, that's all we need to see. You know, the eightfold path of, you know, right action, right thought, right deed, right this and this and this, the Buddha taught that. Ultimately, that can be seen as simply, when you take the big picture path, you see, you can set the whole thing, the whole dream down, just stop waiting. And so you don't need to focus on, wait, how do I act? What do I think now? Same with karma. Karma is only within this dream of rehearsing for transformative bliss. There isn't any, how could it be karma in oneness? There can't be any karma in reality. We never left reality. How can we have karma? We never left reality. It's not possible to have karma. It's only when we take ourselves to be one of these psychic projections in the dream that we think we have karma. But when we see we're not any of these dream figures at all, this is just a rehearsal, a dream rehearsal. Where's the karma? There's no karma. There's no good karma. There's no bad karma. How can there be good karma in reality? That presupposes that there has to be bad karma. How could we generate bad karma in the oneness and the everywhereness and the pure spaciousness? It's impossible. Totally impossible. So what's happening in this era that we're in, getting into right now, the situation, the end of this cycle, is we're more into this quote-unquote non-dual, quicker path, but it's not necessarily that quick because we're kind of having to drop all the other stuff, which kind of we reluctantly let go of all this other teaching, which is difficult. But this gets the ball rolling on a much simpler way to look at the entire thing. We don't have to worry about any of that stuff. But you can't really call it Buddhism or Christianity or Hinduism. You can't really put this into any of the traditions. can't really put it into any of the traditions. Because it basically says, just set the dream down, period. That's it. Nothing else. That's the bliss is there. Oneness is there. It's that simple. The vision of oneness is simply there. It's always been there. We've just been hallucinating blindness. There isn't anything else to say. There's nothing in the dream is real. All this relativism that's happening in the dream, none of that needs to be resolved in the slightest bit. Just like when we wake from a dream, we don't have to resolve all the dream action. Say, wait a minute, I need to go back to sleep because there's all this stuff happening in the dream that I need to bring about a resolution that I feel is a good resolution. You don't need a good resolution, you don't need a bad resolution. You wake up from a nightmare, I don't care. Oh, I was being pursued, I was trapped. I need to go back to sleep and find an escape from that trap. No. We realize it was all unnecessary. It was just a rehearsal dream. See, it's a rehearsal dream. It's important to look at this dream as a rehearsal, as a way of trying to solve a non-existent continuity problem between bliss and transformative bliss. See, we're used to bliss of oneness, and now we say, no, we're going to get transformative bliss. It's going to transform a lack of bliss. This lack of bliss is called waiting. It's basically saying, no, I don't have bliss. I'm waiting for bliss. I'm waiting for bliss. That's what we're saying. We're waiting for oneness. We're waiting for bliss. We're waiting for happiness. It's not here because we're waiting for it in a separate kingdom. We want to experience it in a separate kingdom. So we're in a state of denial. Waiting is really a form of denial. It's just denial. What do you have to wait for in reality? Everything's instantaneous. There's no such thing as waiting for anything. There's no waiting. So waiting is our desire, it's expression of spiritual ambition. Be greater than God, to be different than God, to be separate from God, that's all it is. You got no option except to wait and say, I don't have it yet. Therefore, I don't have it yet. So you say, well, what happens when I have it? I got to rehearse for it, And that will transform my waiting. So all this action of rehearsal, we think that has something to do with bliss. It has nothing to do with it. The dream has nothing to do with bliss, nothing to do with it whatsoever. So nothing needs to be resolved in the dream. We just leave it as it is. Just leave the entire dream exactly as it is, this very moment. Stop waiting. We stop waiting for outcomes. See, the whole dream is a dream of outcomes, is it not? Imaginary outcomes of infinite variety. And we're rehearsing for this unfathomable outcome, right? Of transformative bliss. And so we think we need this infinite rehearsal for it. And all of this rehearsal is important. We need to add it all up. And somehow, eventually, we'll get this idea, this enlightenment, say, oh, now I understand what transformative bliss is. Now I can have that transformative bliss that I've been waiting for. There's no such thing as a bliss that you've been waiting for. You can never wait for bliss. And so, all these outcomes, even dreams, all these potential outcomes, all outcomes, but all potential outcomes are completely meaningless. You don't need to wait for any of them. You don't need to pay attention to any of them. You can wake up from the dream and no longer reference it at all. It's completely useless. Bliss is never transformative. It's always present. It's always instantaneous. There's no gap anywhere. There's no waiting for it ever. There's no waiting for oneness. There is no waiting for oneness. Yeah. And so some of you non-dual people can use that as a book title. There is no waiting for oneness. Or maybe I'll use it. Yeah. I don't know, whatever. There's infinite titles. So what's evolving is this quicker path. I see that now. It just hasn't, you know, been really clarified yet. It's evolving. It's evolving. Is this quicker path, you know, where it's sort of the fruit of Yani Yoga, of the ability to see the big picture, to see the big picture, just look at the big picture, and just say that's all I need. somehow the 100 monkey thing might be prevalent here, is where there's enough of us who are pursuing this and saying, hey, yeah, where at some point it just may crystallize into clarity for us, and then people realize, oh my gosh, there's a simple, easy, clear path. Yeah, I get it. Wow. And leave this past era behind, and not need to even think about it. Really, it's not necessary. Call this the fifth dimension. Call this attitude the fifth dimension. Call this attitude the fifth dimension. Don't have to return. It's where you're quickly de-identifying from all the psychic projections and realizing outcomes are totally irrelevant. I don't have to pay attention to any outcomes. I don't have to search for any outcomes. I don't have to try to bring about any outcomes at all. It doesn't matter. None of it matters in the dream. It's all rehearsal for nothing. Entire dream is a useless rehearsal for nothing. So all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile, meaningless, useless, zero. It's all zero. The entire dream is zero. Zero times zero. The entire dream is just space, not form space. Form space is all these outcomes, just space, really. It's just space. It's all just zero times zero. No more waiting for outcomes. No more waiting for outcomes, right? No more waiting for outcomes. So, I may have been a bit harsh, you know. I'm changing my perspective, which is what the past is all about. Is you keep getting better perspectives, you know. These teachers, a lot of teachers, the non-dual way. We'll see what comes of it. We'll see what comes of it. It may be this sort of organic growing process of this clear, quicker, direct way that, you know, will eventually, you know, catch momentum. It just seems it won't be that effective now, you know, just like, but that's because a lot of people, they're still searching for outcomes, so they're not interested in it. They're still, their spiritual ambition is still severe. So we may have reached out through this era, we may have reached now a point where our ambition has dropped to the point where we can just accept this quick, easy path. And it's not that we're trying to do it better than somebody else. They're actually trying to, by stalling, they're trying to do something, to figure out a better way, which is really to succeed in separating reality. So that's spiritual ambition. To accept reality as it is, there's no spiritual ambition there at all. To wait on it and say, well, wait a minute, that's spiritual ambition. To be waiting on it. So you can't say that taking the quick way to dropping waiting is spiritual ambition. It's really tiredness of spiritual ambition. It's saying, I don't want it. I don't want spiritual ambition. How can you say that saying I don't want spiritual ambition is spiritual ambition? That's just a sort of a logistic insanity, right? It's not sanity. And saying, well, you're doing it faster, so you must be more ambitious. No, I'm extremely tired of this dream of spiritual ambition. So, and I know others will get tired of it too, so I'm trying to find a way to help them drop it fast, because we're just sick and tired of this. Really sick and tired of being sick and tired of frantically pursuing all these outcomes and trying to wrap it up by understanding all outcomes, which just makes your mind go, you know, gives you depression, fatigue, anxiety, all this stuff. We're really tired of this. We want the truth. We want the simple truth so we can, you know, be done with this ridiculousness. So here we're trying to get to it here. We're trying to get to it. Longchenpa, the great Buddhist teacher, Well, that's for another video. Let's leave that for another video. We're on a roll right here, which is fine. There's something going on. There's something going on in these times, for sure. There is really something going on. But let's let it see. Let's let it have its own seat, its own place here. He is a teacher, just says, hey, drop spiritual ambition. That's where it's at. So, you know, he may be the Buddha of the next era, actually, Longchenpa. That's possible. Just like Gautama was the Buddha of this era. Longchenpa may be the Buddha of the next era, so to speak. I don't know. They say Maitreya will be, but who's the one who's going to be Maitreya, whatever. I don't know. But he is the one just to drop spiritual ambition. He's a very simple, very clear, just drop your spiritual ambition. That's all you have to do. Drop your waiting. Drop your waiting. So I seem to have some connection with Longchenpa, which I really don't know. Didn't know ahead, you know, he introduced himself to me. Because I seem to be working along the line, these lines of streamlining. Streamline, streamline, streamline. Streamline the teaching. Get it just crystal clear, you know, really emphasize the root, big picture. Just so you can look at this. You can look at this. It's fine, don't worry. So, maybe there's some affinity there. You know, some affinity, because he seems to be was very much into streamlining. He actually took all the Buddhist teachings before he came and streamlined them and clarified them and got rid of all the contradictions. So he's very much into streamlining. And that's what I'm very much into, is take all religious teachings, streamline the whole thing, simplify the whole thing, and make sure that there's just this easy, clear way, understanding of how to get free of this dream. We don't need to wait for any outcomes. We don't need to wait for karma. Karma just means outcomes. Striving for outcomes, for better and worse. It's a dream concept. But as long as we have this spiritual ambition, karma will seem to be gripping us for sure. And we'll seem to be playing out. But as soon as we realize it's all meaningless, all nothing, I don't need any of it, then I don't need any outcomes. Where's the karma then? It's all extinguished, isn't it? It's extinguished the same way a dream is extinguished by waking from it, where all the outcomes just poof, vanish. You're not interested in outcomes anymore. So basically you're not interested in karma anymore, and it vanishes. It was never really there in the first place. It's all dream. All karma is dream karma. All karma is dream karma. And all dream, the whole dream is simply rehearsal for transformative bliss, supposed to transform this waitingness. And waitingness is to say, I want to be greater than God, and I'm not yet because I'm waiting for the outcome to occur. You know, I'm waiting for the outcome to occur. And of course, that will never occur. But how else can we honor our desire to be greater than God except to say that we're waiting for it? That is the honoring of it, saying we're waiting for it. And of course, as we're waiting for it, we're so uncomfortable, we rehearse for the change, the transformation of this unfulfillment. So the dream arises. It's very simple. It's very simple, actually, the whole thing. It's very simple. Interesting. I was going to store today, and I was ordering some stuff, and I said, you know what, I'm gonna have to call the boss about this. And the guys looked at me and said, what? We thought you were the big. I said, I'm gonna have to call the big boss. And they said, we thought you were the big boss. And I said, no. I said, I may be very impressive to you, but the big boss is more impressive than I am. You know, I should have said way more impressive. We all got a big laugh out of that. See, I guess they were so impressed they thought I was the boss. And I said, I didn't just act like, yeah, I was. You know, I said, no. I'm not. I'm the little boss here. I'm not the big boss. The big boss is way, you know, is way more impressive than I am. Yeah, so I was honest about it, which is interesting. Like someone like Longchenpa is way more impressive. You know, he's like, wow, It's just so impressive. It's just like, wow. It's just like jaw-dropping impressive. You know, just an absolute, complete clarity and simplicity and certitude, completely devoid, you know, of any doubt. It's just, you know, you can feel the utter, beyond certitude. You know, just, that's very impressive. So who knows what's happening, but there's other stuff happening. As you know, the end of this age is going to be a really weird, the outcomes in the dream are going to get really weird. Really weird. Really weird. Because we're trying to force these outcomes. You know, there's all these outcomes that are now sort of coalescing here in this world of all sorts of different, you know, perspectives on what outcome is. You know, there's a competition, the spiritual competition is getting fierce, and the outcomes that they're desired are very conflicting. And so you have this, you know, tremendous conflict in the world, and sneakiness and treachery and subterfuge and sabotage and false flags and all the spookism, you know, that's going on. It's just so unsavory. We live in a most unsavory time, actually. And the great ones of compassion know this, you know, and they're responding to it in some way. So I won't go down that road at this point. We're too much focused on clarity here. But we do need to keep striving to no longer realize we don't need it to focus on outcomes. The same way we don't need to figure out what happened in the dream or go back into the dream to change outcomes. When we awake from the dream, we realize all the outcomes were just fantasy. It doesn't affect the reality we see in the slightest bit. So when we set down the waiting, we realize, oh, the oneness has always been here. Effortlessly so. There wasn't any accomplishment. There's no accomplishment. It's not an outcome. Oneness is not an outcome. Everywhereness is not an outcome. This is a land that is free of outcomes, entirely free of outcomes. And then we say, am I dreaming? You know, it's like, am I dreaming that I'm a butterfly? Or am I a butterfly dreaming that I'm a human? Or you know, that famous saying, did I just awake from a dream? Or was I awake and now I'm dreaming? I'm not sure which one, because this is the land of no outcomes. There's no outcomes. Everything's always one instantaneously. So, spontaneously, instantaneously. So, no need for any outcomes. So which was the dream we were thinking, you know? And then gradually, we need help to realize that the dream was the dream of outcomes. So we see, in the vision of oneness, we see all the forms we used to see as we're dreaming of outcomes. But now we realize there aren't any outcomes. Outcomes are totally irrelevant. No longer attached to outcomes. This is called the great detachment. So all these religions and spiritual teachings, they certainly knew what they were talking about. Absolutely. I'm just wondering if there's a way to, you know, to streamline it. You might call it the high path, but it's really the path for those who are tired of this dream, you know. You can realize, hey, I don't have to go through all that stuff, really. I just repent, say I've got a severe continuity problem, work on the big picture, you know, it melts away, and then that's it. But all of that teaching applies, still applies to some extent. But we may not have to count the trees so much. We can just say, here's the forest. Okay, the forest is a dream. I don't need to keep dreaming of the forest. set it down, set the dream down. Doesn't matter what happens in the forest. I don't need to be counting the trees and what happens from this tree, and how many trees am I setting down. You know, it seems to me that a lot of spiritual teaching tends to go towards how many trees am I setting down? How many outcomes am I setting down? And what were the outcomes that I was setting down? What are the outcomes I'm setting down? Whereas what we want to get to, is I'm just setting one forest down. I'm just setting the forest of outcomes down. It makes absolutely no difference how many outcomes there are, because there's really infinite, because it's ongoing expression of rehearsal. So there isn't any set number. It's all zero as far as a set number, right? So it's really zero times zero I'm setting down. If there is no set number, you can say it's really expressed as zero, right? Because all it is an expression of your rehearsal for transformative bliss, which will never happen, will never happen. So there isn't any right number at all. That's also expressed by zero. So zero times zero. I'm setting the zero times zero forest down. Express it that way. Express it that way. As a null number, really. Because since there isn't any number, you can say it's a null, a nullity, or zero. So we're just saying, we're just setting the whole forest down. One forest, just the forest, setting it all down. And not counting the outcomes. How many outcomes do we set down? Do we set one down first or second or third? No, we set the whole thing down at once, all at one time. We wake up from a dream. We're waking up from all the outcomes of a dream equally, right, at the same time. So it's a null, it's a zero. It's like a zero times zero. So I don't know where these teachings come from. It comes from the light somehow. Because I'm like amazed by them myself. I'm just like, whoa, never thought of that before. Zero is a nullity, meaning it's indeterminate, completely indeterminate. Because as long as we want to rehearse, we'll keep rehearsing outcomes. So there is no set limit. There is no number, way to express it, really, other than zero. One moment, please. Yeah, so this is just the, you know, somehow the language of light, you know, is expressing itself. It was just great. I love it. I love it. This is wonderful. This is what I want to hear. I'm kind of like saying the things I've always wanted to hear. But how can I do that? I don't know. That experience of the light I had, where I was comfortable with it, intense, pure light, you know, I was comfortable with it. Somehow since then, I've been able to talk in clear way, sort of expressing from the light, listening to the light. So this idea of zero's nullity is very important. It's indeterminacy. Indeterminacy, wow. Total indeterminacy of number can be expressed by zero, numerically, right? As far as meaning. How many do we set down? It's totally indeterminate. So it's really, can be expressed by zero. See, zero's not a number. It's not one. So zero is kind of like, can it be a term for complete indeterminacy? Can it? Very interesting. Very interesting indeed. One minute, please. Okay, all sorts of outcomes are in the world, or people are frantically, you need to do this, all sorts of outcomes, you know, so I need to attend to these, you know, dream outcomes, you know, keep chopping wood and carrying water here. Very great. So this has been a very nice video, very helpful for me, and hopefully it's been helpful for you and for many. So let's see what happens next. Wow, I don't even want to speculate. Zero times zero. That's it.